edition of the TV on Basketball Podcast with your host TV, and we are back again with another podcast episode, and we are going to be doing another top 10. And today's top 10 we're going to be doing is a team that I'm surprised I haven't even done yet. It's one of the most prolific franchises of all time, one of the longest standing ones, and honestly one of the most successful ones, especially in the 90s. We got to talk about the Chicago Bulls here. And yeah, I'm very excited to come with you with this video, and I can't wait to go through this top 10 list. But before we get into this top 10 list, I obviously have to do my plugging. Please remember to follow at TV on Basketball on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram for updates on the podcast and for other content. If you're watching this on YouTube, please remember to please like, share, and subscribe to show your support for the podcast and all that good stuff. If you're listening to this on the good old podcast networks, if you're on Apple Podcasts, remember to please subscribe, share with your friends. If you're on Podbean, remember to please follow, like, and also, again, share with your friends. And remember, we're also on Anchor and Spotify. So, look, of all these podcast networks, it would be really great if you could support this podcast, basically. And I've been getting a lot of, like, good support over the last, you know, especially during this quarantine, I've got a substantial amount more downloads and views, and I really appreciate you guys for showing your support. So please continue to do that, and please like this video, especially if you're on the YouTube. So, and yeah, again, thank you guys for all the support. But yeah, before we get into the Chicago Bulls top 10 list, the NBA season starts tomorrow. Most of the podcasts going forward, we're still going to be having the typical Wednesday top 10 list, but every Monday and Friday, it's not really going to be anything super special. Maybe we might we're basically going to be talking about a lot of NBA news. Maybe we might add a little twist to it just to make it a bit more, you know, engaging and stuff like that. But with the NBA season coming back on Thursday, which is tomorrow, I know we are all very excited for that. There's going to be a lot of news to talk about, especially, you know, most of the scrimmage games are done. I just watched my Raptors get beaten by the Phoenix Suns yesterday where, yeah, Devin Booker posterized Pascal Siakam. But with the season games coming in, now this is where stuff really matters. This is where, a lot of the things could change over these next eight games. So, yeah, it's going to be a lot of great episodes coming up in the future. Still going to keep the same schedule. Mondays and Fridays, you're going to be having the NBA news podcasts. Wednesdays, we're still going to be hitting you with some top 10s. If there's something really urgent we have to talk about on the Wednesdays, I will add that to the episode as well. But, yeah, besides that, we're going to just keep chugging along, and there's going to be a lot more stuff to talk about when the NBA season finally kicks off starting tomorrow, so very excited about that. But yeah, with that out the way, let us get right into talking about the Chicago Bulls. And the Chicago Bulls, at this very moment, aren't in a great situation. They are not one of the 22 bubble teams. Some people had a lot of expectations for them going into this season because, you know, Zach LaVine, another year under his belt, they brought in some nice veterans like Thomas Satoransky and Thad Young. It just felt like maybe this team wasn't going to, be a playoff contender by any means, but it felt like they might be, challenging for a playoff spot. And with Jim Boylan, they thought, he had some bad reputation as coach the last year. He can't get any worse this year. And to be honest, it kind of has. It really has for the Chicago Bulls. They're not in a very good situation right now. With all this happening, I think this is the best time to give a tease to fire Jim Boylan. And I think it's gonna need a lot more help for Zach LaVine and Lauri Markkanen. There's a lot of question marks with this roster, and we just really don't know where they're gonna go from here. We've heard stories about Lauri Markkanen being frustrated with the team. We don't know how Zach LaVine really feels about the situation. I mean, he's getting his points, but he's going to be a free agent in 2022, I believe. So that's going to be extremely interesting to, follow. And, yeah, it's going to be really interesting to see how stuff with the current Chicago Bulls pans out. But they are not the topic of today's episode. We're going to be looking back at some of the great Chicago Bulls that have played in, you know, the legendary United Center. They've had some great eras of their team. You can go back to the 90s where obviously they were absolutely dominant, and They haven't been like a super scrubby franchise. I mean, in the 70s, they've made like quite a number of playoff appearances. And although they haven't had a championship since Jordan's final season with the Bulls, you know, they've had a few of like pretty decent teams with some pretty damn good players like since then. So I'm going to be very excited to talk about them on this list. So yeah, we're going to start going right into this list. Obviously, we're going to have my three honorable mentions, then we're going to go into the top 10. And yeah, let's do this. So my first honorable mention on this list is we're going to be talking about is Tony Kukoc. Yes, Tony Kukoc played 436 games for the team, averaged 14.1 points per game, 4.8 rebounds a game, 4.2 assists. Was also the 1996 Sixth Man of the Year, three-time NBA champion with the Bulls, 1994 All-Rookie Team. He's also top 10 in steals, assists, and threes. Well, we all remember from the Last Dance, you know, the docuseries where, you know, Tony Kukoc, like early on in his career, was attacked by Jordan and Pippen, most notably during the 1992 Olympics, the Dream Team Olympics. And this guy was tough-skinned. I mean, he had a pretty bad first game when he was playing for Croatia against, you know, Michael and Pippen. But when the finals came around, he showed up, and, you know, he quickly gained the respect. And the thing about Tony Kukoc was, like, this guy was an integral part of their, especially during the second three-peat. I know he started off his career, you know, with after Jordan retired and stuff like that. But when Jordan came back and they started going on that second three-peat, he was very, very important to that roster. And like I said, like I mentioned, he won the Sixth Man of the Year award. Like, he was one of the best bench players of that decade. Like, he was, he was able to handle the ball. He had a great shooting range. This guy stood at 6'10", by the way. Like, this guy was a very long player. He could, you know, he could do it on especially on the offensive end. Like, he was a great shooter. Like, it was very hard to defend his shot. And, you know, he, like I said, integral part of the team. Like, you can't, like, deny, like, how, how, important he was to, like, that three-peat run. Like, he was able to, like, provide offense when Pippen and Michael, like, needed a break and stuff like that. And that is very important, especially in these championship teams. Like, it does, like, obviously it's great to have someone like Michael Jordan and all that. Like, and obviously he's the biggest reason why these championships happen. But you gotta remember, there's, like, other, like, you know, good role players, and Tony Kukoc was just one of them. And like I said, won three championships with the team. You can't deny, like, you know, he was a, like, not, like, you know, like a side character. Like, someone who, like, didn't really affect the team. He really did. Like, he was one of the better bench players of that decade, and he definitely showed it in his run with the Bulls. So, yeah, one of my first honorable mention has to go to Tony Kukoc. The second honorable mention is someone who was not part of the second DP team, is part of the first DP team, and one of the top players for the Bulls besides Jordan and Pippen at the time. We're going to be talking about Horace Grant, who played 546 games for the team, averaged 12.6 points, 8.4 rebounds, 4.4 assists. Again, three-time NBA champion with the Bulls, two-time all-defense, one-time all-star, top 10 in steals, blocks, minutes, rebounds, and number three in field goal percentage. He was like the, you know, like Pippen and Jordan obviously ran the show, but Horace Grant was a very, like, underrated piece in that starting lineup. Like, this, like, I've talked about him in the Top 10 Orlando Magic Players podcast, but yeah, he was just a very good, like, you know, hustle player. This guy could play defense, and when called upon, he could score. As seen, like, you know, when Jordan left, like, he was able to, you know, have a pretty good season, you know, averaging over 15 points and stuff like that. Like, he made his first All-Star appearance with the Bulls during that season. And same case with Tony Kukoc. You can obviously point to Michael and Pippen as the main reason for the championship, but you need to have a good supporting cast around it. And Horace Grant was just one of those players. Like I talked about last time, a lot of people love Horace Grant because of the way he, just the effort he put on both ends of the court. This guy was a fantastic rebounder, and this guy was respected on the defensive end. He made two all defensive teams. And, you know, the man with goggles, you know, he had his fair share of controversies during his time with the Bulls. Obviously, the whole thing with the Jordan rules book, and all that. Like, there was some, like tough talking points with him, Horace Grant. But at the same time, you cannot deny his impact on those, like, on the first three-peats. And, you know, he really came into his own at the Chicago Bulls. I mean, he had some good success also with the Magic afterwards. But, you could say that his best years were with the Chicago Bulls, and sadly he couldn't make this top 10, but he definitely deserves to have some recognition. So that's why my second honorable mention is Horace Grant. My third and final honorable mention on this list is a very much as current as you get on this list with Chicago Bulls players. We have Jimmy Butler. Yes, Jimmy Buckets, who played 399 games for the team, 15.6 points a game, 4.8 rebounds, 3.1 assists. During his time with Chicago, a three-time NBA All-Star, 2017 All-NBA, was the 2015 Most Improved Player, three-time All-Defense, and was also in top 10 in steals per game, and free throws. Honestly, he's easily their best player over the last 5 years. Jimmy Butler had to take reins after the whole, you know, Derrick Rose got into the situation. Like, they needed to get that next guy up. And instead of, like, they didn't have to look into the free agency and all that. They had someone right underneath their nose who they drafted with the 30th pick in the 2011 draft. Jimmy Butler's story is absolutely fantastic. If you have the time and day, please search it up. It's honestly very inspirational. But the whole premise of that is that Jimmy Butler had to work for everything he had. And I think that's what really resonated with Chicago Bulls fans. They just loved that, you know, hardworking type of player. The thing about Jimmy Butler is, like, you know, he had to be a role player early on in his career. But when he took reins as the number one guy, sure, they didn't have much success. I don't think they even made past the first or second round, and I'm not 100% sure on that, but this guy was a good player. He was a very good offensive player, but he did make his money on the defensive end. This guy was absolutely ruthless, one of the best on-ball defenders to this day in the NBA. And, you know, he doesn't crack the top 10 because he didn't have that sort of success, but at the same time, you know, one of their, like, he was their number one guy for quite a number of years. I mean, he was a very good player for them, and it was messy. It was a messy leave for the especially like his situation, his relationship with the Bulls management. The fans still love him. I think, like, that's pretty much clear. I think most people, especially the Chicago Bulls fans still love Jimmy. It's questionable for Timberwolves fans, but yeah, that's a completely different scenario. But Jimmy Butler is still well loved, well respected, and by Bulls fans. And, you know, like I said, being a great player for them, being the 30th overall pick, like, it's just like his whole story. Again, please check it out. But it was great, like, when he finally got his opportunity, and even to this day, like, he's still having a lot of success. If he had it even slightly a bit more, like, success, if he even made a conference finals, he probably would have made the list, but sadly he didn't. So he just makes it right outside the top 10. But yeah, those are our three honorable mentions. Let us get right into the top 10. And yeah, let's get right into this. And at number 10, we're going to be starting off with like I said, with Jimmy Butler, someone who played for them, like, just recently, over the last 10 years. We're going to be talking about Mr. Joakim Noah, who played 572 games with the team, 9.3 points a game, 9.4 rebounds, 3.0 assists, 2014 Defensive Player of the Year, 2014 All-NBA, two-time All-Star, three-time All-Defense, and is also top 10 in games, minutes, steals, top 5 in rebounds, and blocks. You know, the thing about Joakim Noah is that stats don't do this guy justice. You can look at those 2010... the early 2010 Bull teams, and you can look at the stats of people like a Luol Deng, like a Carlos Boozer, and said, you know, they definitely put up better stats than Joakim Noah. But if you watch the games, if you know, like, his impact on the floor, you could tell that he was the second best player during that Derrick Rose Bulls era, like, kind of mixed in with the Jimmy Butler era. But the thing is, like, this guy was one of the best defensive players in the league in the early, over the last decade. And yeah, Derrick Rose did lead the Bulls on the offensive end during those early 2010 season. But Noah was their defensive anchor. This guy was fantastic at blocking shots, defending in the post, and was arguably, like, even though Derrick Rose was putting up the numbers, you could argue that he was the most important player on that team. And he made multiple All-Star games. He also made an All-NBA team. And during that season where he made All NBA, people like recognized, wanted to give him his recognition, and he actually, I believe, came top five in MVP voting that season, which is absolutely crazy. And what a lot of people will remember about Joakim Noah is just the passion he played for the game. You can remember him just like, you know, his like infamous, you know, screaming and all that. And kind of like Jimmy Butler, is like just the passion he gave to the Chicago Bulls organization during that time. You know, you just like a lot of fans like really, you know, were drawn to that. And that's why a lot of people like see Joakim Noah as a cult hero for the Chicago Bulls franchise. And, you know, one of the ugliest jumpers I have ever seen in my life, that Joakim Noah jumper. But, you know, still a decent free throw percentage shooter. I believe he was near 70% in his career, so it wasn't horrible. But for someone who was an elite player in the early 2010s, I don't think he gets enough credit. I did a post on him, like a Let's Talk About post on him on my Instagram just a few days ago. And, you know, like, this guy was a top three center arguably at this time, like in the early 2010s. So, you know, Joakim Noah definitely deserves some respect in this on this list. I have him coming in at number 10. We move on to number 9, and we're going to be going with one of the, I don't want to say the oldies of this list. At number 9, we have Norm Van Leer. Yes, I honestly, when doing research for this list, I just figured about him a few days ago. But he probably had a damn good career. 535 games with the Bulls. 12.2 points per game, 4.7 rebounds, 6.9 assists, 3-time NBA All-Star, 8-time All-Defense, was part of the 1974 All-NBA team, 1971 assist champ, and was also top 10 in assist steals minutes, top 5 in steals per game and assists per game for the Bulls franchise. Stormin' Norman, as he would like to be called, you know, was one of the best defenders in Bulls history and was part of the more successful eras before pre-Michael Jordan. Him and Jerry Sloan made up the backcourt in the 70s, and they were highly touted as one of the best defensive backcourts during that era. And, you know, they made the playoffs 5 times when he was with the team, and, you know, 3 All-Star appearances along with 8 defensive teams. Like, that is what really cemented his legacy for the Chicago Bulls. Was never the best player for the Bulls, but was a very important part to that team. I believe he was also there when they made their first Western Conference Finals, when the Bulls were part of the Western Conference back in the day. And, you know, as one of those guys, I mean, with like some of these guys on this list, I'm not going to know much about because they are definitely before my time playing in the 70s and all that. But, you know, by doing my research, by, you know, seeing the stats, the accolades and everything, you have to show some respect to some of these, like, older, you know, players from these franchises. And Norman Van Leer, one of the most important players for the Bulls franchise in the early 70s, he deserves to have his name on the list. We move on to number 8, and we go with another player from the 90s from the Bulls. There's going to be quite a number of them on this list. But at number 8, we are be going with Dennis Rodman, who played 199 games for the team. Obviously, he's a Hall of Famer. 5.2 points per game, 15.3 rebounds per game, 2.8 assists. You know, 2-time All-Defense, 4-time rebound champion, 1995 All-NBA, 3-time NBA champion, obviously with the second three-peat Bulls, number 1 in rebounds per game, top 10 in offensive rebounds. You know, Dennis Rodman had a very, very interesting career with the Bulls, and his, like, you know, he only played it for a short time as well, only 199 games. Like, I think this is, like, far less than basically everyone else on this list. But he was their hustle guy, and during that second three-peat, he was their third-best player. And what made him such a good third option, and it shows how important he was that you knew he was on the court at all times. You had to always account for him. He was a third-best player, but he didn't need the ball at his hands at all times. He was always rebound hunting, you know, one of arguably the best rebounder in NBA history, especially for someone at that size. People don't remember, he's only 6'8", and he is one of the best rebounders of all time. People like him, people like Charles Barkley, really impressed me with their their nose for the rebound, especially at their, you know, at their small, at their relatively shorter stature. And, you know, this guy played with a lot of passion. He flashed hard for every single possession. You know, he was always, like I said, that he was the hustle guy, one of the best hustle guys in the NBA. And with Dennis Rodman, he obviously had his, you know, off the court moments. Obviously, he had his, like, he would sometimes leave the team. Like, he was on WWE TV, if you remember The Last Dance. he also like needed a break sometimes, so he had to go to freaking Las Vegas and spend a weekend there. Like, this guy was a very interesting character. But with the Bulls and why they allowed him to do that, they knew what he could give them on the basketball court. And sure, Dennis Rodman had to do his Dennis Rodman thing. They had to deal with it. And obviously it wasn't an ideal situation for the Bulls. Definitely not. But, you know, when he was on the court, and that's all that really mattered, he produced. And the Bulls trusted that. And that's why they gave him free reign. That's why they gave him the freedom to do, you know, have these little moments. Because they knew that once this guy got on the basketball court, he was going to give you 110%. And that's just a Dennis Rodman way. You're going to have to take the good with the bad. And in his NBA career, the good really overtook the bad. So, coming at number 8, Dennis Rodman. Coming in at number 7 is another one of these 70s players. But this guy, you know, didn't win an MVP with Chicago Bulls, but this guy was an ABA legend, and I think this is like his, like, he had his best tenure with the Chicago Bulls in the NBA. So coming in at number 7, we have Artis Gilmore. The Hall of Famer played 482 games with the Chicago Bulls, averaged 19.3 points per game, 11.1 rebounds, 2.5 assists, was a 4-time NBA All-Star, top 10 in minutes, field goals, blocks, points, rebounds, number 4 in rebounds per game, and number 1 in blocks per game. I mean, like I said, he had his best years playing for the ABA. I think he played for a team in Kentucky where he won the MVP in his rookie season, which is absolutely insane. But his best, like I said, best in the NBA was with Chicago Bulls. I think still to this day, he is like number 1 in field goal percentage in NBA history. So that just tells you all you need to know that Artis Gilmore was one of the most efficient scorers of all time. Along with that, being a phenomenal rebounder, an elite defender, you know, making a multiple two all-defense teams, which I didn't list earlier. But, you know, looking at just the storied history of the Chicago Bulls, this guy is their best center of all time. Never had someone like, since Artis Gilmore, with the type of talent they had at the center position. He was, like, his ability to score in the post, and how efficiently he scored. And, you know, some of his stats, like, he's still number 4 in rebounds a game, blocks a game. Like, he really, like, his name is still all over, like, top 10, like, career leaders list for the Chicago Bulls. And with the talent he possessed at the time, and he was part of that team, like I said, along with Norm Van Leer and some other guys who will also be on this list, like, he was part of those teams. And they had, like, probably the best success, like, until Jordan came around. So, yeah, Artis Gilmore, great player in his own right. Again, one of those like great 70s players, which I couldn't really watch because and way before my time. But you got to show respect to some of these guys like from the early days of Chicago Bulls. And Artis Gilmore is one of them. And that's why he made it on this list. Coming in at number 6, we have another one of those players that played alongside Artis Gilmore. We are going with Shea Walker, who, again, another Hall of Famer, 474 games with the team, 20.6 points per game, 6.1 rebounds per game, 2.3 assists per game, was a 4-time NBA All-Star with the Chicago Bulls, top 10 in points and field goals, number 5 in points per game. With Shea Walker, this guy was just a bona fide star at the time, basically, and he was one of the first stars for the Chicago Bulls franchise. He, like I said, over 20 points a game, which is highly impressive. He won a championship in Philly, and you can argue that he had his better times with the Philadelphia 76ers back in the day. But, you know, when he came to Chicago in that trade, he still put up big numbers, and he was a great player for them. You know, the Hall of Famer had a great run with the, you know, with like that like solid cast, which I've mentioned multiple times on this podcast. You know, we're going to still talk about a couple of them like later on this list. And along with that, you know, the Bulls made multiple playoff appearances during that era, and Shea Walker was a big part of it. A very good scorer at his time, and, you know, a very, like, successful Bulls era, definitely, like, in the 70s, making multiple playoff appearances. And Shea Walker was one of the leading scorers for that team, and I believe, like, if you look at just career stats, like, I think only one guy, like, averaged more points for him during that era. So, yeah, Shea Walker definitely deserves some love on this list. He is coming in at number 6. Coming in at number 5, we have And again, another 70s player. But that 70s team was very good. That they had a ton of Hall of Famers on that team, and they will continue to be recognized in Bulls history. And I think this is the first player to have his jersey retired by a team. This is the first one on the list, and that player is going to be Bob Love. Another Hall of Fame. I don't believe he's made the Hall of Fame, but 592 games with the team. His number 10 jersey is retired, obviously. 21.3 points per game, 6.8 rebounds, 1.7 assists, three-time All Defense, two-time All Star, two-time All NBA, top 10 in games, minutes, field goals, rebounds, top 5 in points per game, and minutes per game. Bob Love at the time was a highly athletic power forward, and didn't have a great start to his career, but once he got traded to the Bulls in '68, his career just skyrocketed. This guy found his place in the league and was a very good player for the Chicago Bulls. One of the best scoring forwards at the time. And the thing about him with Bob Love and what I think made him the best player during that '70 Bulls era was that he wasn't just elite on the offensive end, like one of the best scoring forwards, but this guy was a fantastic defensive player, making two. Three all defense teams. I didn't really talk about this earlier with the other guys, but actually, no, I think I mentioned that when I was talking about Van Leer. But they made two Western Conference Finals during that time. I believe one was where they got swept by the Warriors, and the second one, they won seven games, I believe, with the Utah Jazz or something. So, and Bob Love was the best player on those teams. So, again, a very good player for his time. And his top, as I listed before, this guy's name is already in all these top 10 lists, like career leaders list for the Bulls. And his presence is definitely known in Bulls history. So that's why coming in at number five, we have Bob Love. Coming in at number four, I believe is going to be the final member of those 70 Bulls teams. But this guy, the original Bull, the first pick from their expansion. Like when they did the expansion draft back in the 60s, this guy was their first pick, playing 696 games for the team, the Hall of Famer, Jerry Sloan. His number four jersey is retired there as well. Averaged 14.7 points per game, 7.7 rebounds, 2.6 assists, two All-Star games, six-time All-Defense, top five in minutes, games, points, field goals, and field goals. Top five, top 10 in a lot of other areas as well, by the way. Like I said, this guy was the first pick when they did the expansion draft back in the 60s. And, I mean, his nickname is the Original Bull. This guy has to be a top five bull of all time. And what was crazy about Jerry Sloan is, like I mentioned before, him and Nick, sorry, not, I was going to say Nick Van Leer. I was going to say Vic. Oh my gosh, NBA 2K. But, him and Norm Van Leer, one of the best, made up one of the most fearsome defensive backcourts of the 70s. And with Jerry Sloan, one of his most impressive traits is how good he could rebound the ball from the guard position. I've listed some of these other guys. He averaged more rebounds than Bob Love, who played the power forward position. So, Jerry Sloan, one of the better defenders of his era, recognized due to two All-Star games, six All-Defensive selections. And, he had this rebound sense of a power forward center, and he was still a very good two guard for the Chicago Bulls. And they made the playoffs eight times in his career, while playing for the Bulls. And he is the first player to have his jersey retired by the Bulls. His number four jersey is hanging from the rafters. And like I said about a lot of these guys, this guy is the ultimate OG Bulls member. They're literally their first pick in the expansion draft. You got to show some love to him. And I believe this is the same Jerry Sloan that played and that coached later on in his career. So, he just died, I think, over the last few months. RIP to the guy, one of the greatest coaches of all time. And again, one of the OG Bulls players from back in the day. So, yeah, coming in at number four, we have Jerry Sloan. Now we're going to go into the top three. And this top three, highly, highly talented. I think you could see where this type of list is going. I haven't said started players up to this point. So yeah, let's get right into it. Coming in at number three, we have the man that rose from the concrete. You see what I did there. Yeah, that was horrible. But coming in at number three, we have Mr. Derrick Rose, who plays 460 games for the team, 19.7 points per game, 3.7 rebounds, 6.2 assists, was the 2011 MVP, three-time All-Star, 2011 All-NBA, was the 2009 Rookie of the Year, top 10 in field goals, points per game, top 5 in assists, and also assists per game. I think it's pretty safe to say that Derrick Rose was the best player to play for the Bulls during this century. I don't think there's much argument there. And, you know, the youngest MVP in NBA history. This guy seemed like he was destined for greatness. This guy, like, coming in the number one pick in the 2008 draft, he showed us right away that this guy, that he was going to be a special player. He was going to be an absolutely special player. And he was on that trajectory to be just a surefire Hall of Fame type of guy. He had top-tier athleticism. This guy had tremendous, awesome passing ability, was a scoring machine. And the Bulls thought, man, we got our, like, I mean, Michael Jordan's on a whole new level, but this is, like, a new era. This could be, like, something special here post the, like, after, like, the whole, like, successful 90s era, that they could, like, make some noise during this time. But the story with Derrick Rose, whenever you have to talk about the man, you got to talk about the injuries, which is absolutely unfortunate. Whether it's the ACL injuries, the meniscus injuries, the PC, like, it's just the Achilles. It just sucked for Derrick Rose throughout his entire career. And it was, like, that infamous 2012 playoff series against the Philadelphia 76ers where, with 1 minute left, you know, they were up by 20-plus points, and Tom Thibodeau still had the guy in. Absolutely unfortunate the way that he had to go down in that series. And, you know, like I said, Bulls fans were very optimistic about this team. And they had a good roster around Derrick Rose. I mentioned Joakim Noah. They had a young and upcoming star at the time with Jimmy Butler. Carlos Boozer, pretty good player for them on the roster. Luol Deng. Like, they had a pretty damn good roster. But when your number one guy is just, you know, getting injury after injury, it's tough to find that just that continuous success. And it's really unfortunate for Derrick Rose. Like he was one of my favorite players of all time. And the thing was, like, it was, like, super sad seeing him just get injured at the time. I had, like, all his gear and all that. Like, he was, like, a big, you know, like, one of, like, a role model for kids for sure during that time. And it was super sad the way that, like his career kind of really down spiraled. And it really got back to the point where he almost retired, but, you know, he came back, became, like, especially this season and the last season, became one of the league's best bench players and is now in the running for the Sixth Man of the Year award. So the way he bounced back from those injuries, that's, like, very inspirational. This guy, one of the best bench players in the league for sure. And, I mean, it just sucks because he's one of the NBA's biggest, you know, what-if scenarios. Like, what if Derrick Rose didn't get injured? Like, where would he be all time on the, like, in the point guards list? Like, all, like, where would he be in the all-time NBA list? Like, it's absolutely unfortunate. And what sucks about this is that he could be the first MVP in NBA history to not make the Hall of Fame, which would be absolutely ludicrous. But, you know, these injuries definitely are against him for his Hall of Fame candidacy. And hopefully, I still hope he does. I still think he deserves to be in the Hall of Fame, but we're gonna have to wait and see on that one. But, you know, he's still one of the best Chicago Bulls of all time. He had a lot of great memories. My biggest one of him being that dunk over Goran Dragic, especially with the Bulls announcer reaction. He provided a lot of great memories for my childhood, and was a big like I said, the number one guy for the Bulls at the time. So, yeah, coming in at number three, we have Derrick Rose. Now we're gonna get to the top two, and it's kind of obvious where it's going to go from here, but I definitely will continue to speak out on these guys. So coming in at number two, we have one half of the Batman and Robin of the 90s Bulls teams. We have one of the greatest players in NBA history. We have Scottie Pippen, who played 856 games for the team. His number 33 jersey is retired and is also a Hall of Famer. 16.7 points per game, 6.7 rebounds, 5.3 assists, 7 All-Stars, 7 All-NBAs, 6-time champion, 10-time All-Defense, top 5 in points, assists, rebounds, steals, blocks, everything basically on this list. Scottie Pippen you're going to see his name somewhere. Although, you know, he was the number 2 guy on that team, like, you cannot deny how great of a player Scottie Pippen was. this guy was like one of the originators of the point forward position. And with him, like being someone who stands at 6'8", being able to handle the ball, play make the way he does, being one of the best perimeter defenders, scratch that, one of the best defenders of all time, definitely puts him on this list and like really should show how great of a player he was back in the day. He's also like looked at as one of the greatest 50 players of all time. And, you know, like, this guy, like I said, like, he just had, like a unique skill set that cannot, like, that it was very hard, like, to, like, replicate back in the day. And even still, like, to this, like, to this day, like, he still is regarded as, like, one of the better players in NBA history. Obviously, he had his moments for the Bulls where, you know, it kind of got ugly, especially with the contract negotiations, like his, like, pretty bad relationship with Jerry Krause. But you can't say that this guy, like, they couldn't have won anything. If you take Scottie Pippen off those teams, they're not winning a single championship. Michael Jordan recognized that. I think a lot of people who watch the NBA will recognize that, that Scottie Pippen was, like, an extremely important member of that roster. And to tell you what, Scottie, like, we've seen him as a number one option, you know, after Michael Jordan retired for the first time. He had a very good season the first year, made it to the second round of the Eastern Conference playoffs, which is pretty good. But at the same time, you know, couldn't, like, wasn't, like, in a, like, great position. Obviously, we know that from people who did watch The Last Dance, he had that, like, you know, scenario in, during the first, I think the second round of that playoffs where he forced himself out of the game with 10 seconds left because he wasn't taking the final shot. Seemed extremely petty at the time. They still won the game. And it was one of those scenarios that, you know, it's kind of a blemish on the Scottie Pippen resume, like quite a number of, like one of the very few blemishes. But, you know, that hardly takes anything away from the legacy that he brought to the Bulls. This guy was just a fantastic NBA player, and that's all there is to it. You know, his unique skill set made him, like, the perfect number two with Michael Jordan, honestly the best Robin in NBA history. And, you know, like I said, like he had his rough times with the Bulls, but being like on that, you know, ridiculous 7-year contract where he made, I think, $24 million, like this guy, like being like the, having like the type of contract he had, like made it even like more crazy that he, was able to like be that good and like just get that little money and just be that like great of a player. Like, this guy could was arguably a top 10 player at that time. It was just crazy to, like the way like this whole situation played out, but 6 championships, absolute Hall of Fame career, Scottie Pippen coming in at number 2 on this list. And coming in at number 1, I was about to make a joke. I was thinking, like, how I can, like, twist it to a joke. I was going to do something with Brian Celebrini and all that. But it was, you just can't. Number 1 on this list, you got to go with the GOAT himself. You got to go with Michael Jeffrey Jordan. 930 games played for the team. Number 23 retired, obviously. Hall of Famer. 31.5 points per game, 6.3 rebounds per game, 5.4 assists per game, 12-time All-Star, 10-time scoring champion, 6-time champion, 5-time MVP, 11-time All-NBA, 6-time Finals MVP, 9-time All-Defensive Team, the 1988 Defensive Player of the Year. Well, just look at the stuff that he is number one in Bulls history. Number one in points, minutes, field goals, games, rebounds, assists, steals. You get the point. Simply the greatest Bull to play in all time, and in my opinion, the greatest player of all time in NBA history. He was the hardest worker, the best offensive player on the court, the best defensive player on the court at all times, and that's basically like unmatched in NBA history. I'm going to get this out the way now. Whether you believe LeBron's the GOAT, whether you believe Michael's the GOAT, I would love to hear your thoughts, by the way. Put it down in the comment section. But at the same time, you know, the way that Jordan, you know, carried the Bulls, the way that he carried himself, the way that he just played basketball is unmatched in NBA history. And I'm not afraid to say that. Like, if we could look at the plethora of game winners. Some of my favorite, obviously the one over the Jazz, but my personal favorite, the one over Craig Elo in 1989 playoffs. It's like personally one of my favorite game winners of all time. You can think of some of the dunks, whether you want to talk about the dunk contest ones, the dunk over Dikembe Mutombo. There's just so many of those. You want to talk about the crossovers? Obviously, the Byron Russell crossover to win them the final championship during the time. There's just so many. Like, Michael Jordan is not only like plastered, like he's like the first person you think of when you think of just basketball in general. This guy is the face of the Bulls. This guy is the face of basketball. He is the icon of basketball worldwide. And whether you want to just like discuss like what his biggest impact was it on the, basketball culture? You want to talk about how like he just carried himself on the basketball court just because he was just that good, and or like anything of that sort. Michael Jordan was just the best, and he wanted to prove that day in and day out. Everything he did it for winning. And he talked about a lot in his in the Last Dance documentary. Like, you could talk about all the all these the things that he got, all the recognition. You could talk about all the shoe deals, the the acclaim and all that, but he couldn't like all the fame. Sorry, that's what I meant to say. But you could talk about all that, but he did because of how great he was on the basketball court. And like I said, it's basically like almost unmatched the way he did it. Like, six finals appearances, six championships. Really hard to dispute that. And he did everything in his power to try and win basketball games. The accolades speak for itself. The impact on the basketball community speaks for itself. Just the name Michael Jordan speaks for itself. And if you have anyone else on this Bulls list not named Michael Jordan number one, then you were just sadly mistaken. Like, you're just watching the wrong sport. Maybe you're watching baseball or something like that, but there's no doubt that Michael Jordan is number one on this all-time Bulls list. Like, if you said anything otherwise, he would definitely take it personally. But there's only one MJ, and yeah, Michael Jordan, number one Bulls player of all time. And that is the list. Please leave your thoughts in the comment section below, whether you agree with my list, who would you change around, and all that good stuff. I would love to hear from you guys. And yeah, this is a fantastic, another great top 10 to make. Lots of great players in the history of the Chicago Bulls. You can't deny that. And when you have Michael Jordan as your number one guy, it's really hard to say that you're not one of the greatest franchises in NBA history. But, with the list being done and all that, I think this is where we're going to end the episode. Remember, if you're listening on YouTube again, I'm going to want to reiterate this. Please like, share, and subscribe. That'd be very much appreciated. Always love the support for the podcast. If you're listening on any of my podcasts, remember to please share. Do whatever you can on that app just to like spread the word on this podcast. And remember to please follow all my social media platforms. TV on Basketball, you can find me on all the social media networks. That'd be very much appreciated. Remember to check out also my last episode, which I did another episode with Critical Condition Sports, where we made our bold predictions for the upcoming NBA, the seeding games / playoffs. It's going to be, that was a very good episode, so I really do recommend you check that out. But yeah, since we got all the way, I'm going to think we're going to end it right here. Thank you guys for listening. Hopefully, I'm going to be back for you guys on Friday, recapping some of the first NBA seeding games. We're going to go into depth about that and just other news from around the league. But yeah, until then, thank you guys for listening. Hope you all have a fantastic day. Enjoy yourselves. Peace.